إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة ولنجزينهم أجرهم بأحسن ما كانوا يعملون. وقال تعالى: ومن أعرض عن ذكري فإن له معيشة ضنكا ونحشره يوم القيامة أعمى. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: قد أفلح من أسلم ورزق كفافا وقنعه الله بما آتاه. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Honorable علماء اكرام، respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, as Sheikh has introduced the topic to you, depression versus contentment. While the world continues to progress technologically, I swear by Allah, faster than its growth in technology, it is retrogressing morally and spiritually. We find ourselves being exposed to a society that has become so immoral. Like Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu anhu said, معروف زماننا منكر زمان قد مضى ومنكره معروف زمان لم يأتي. Such deep words, food for thought. Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu anhu said, معروف زماننا, the good of our times were the sins of the previous times. What you and I consider as noble, as pious, as righteous was considered a sin, a vice and transgression in the previous times. وَمَعْرُوفُ زَمَانِنَا مُنْكَرُ زَمَانٍ قَدْ مَضَى وَمُنْكَرُهُ مَعْرُوفُ زَمَانٍ لَمْ يَأْتِ. And what we consider as vice and as evil and as wrong today will be considered noble and pious in the time that is to come. That is why in Bukhari there is one commentary where one Sahabi addressing his companion said, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَعْمَلُونَ أَعْمَالًا هِيَ أَدَقُّ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ كنا نعدها في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الموبقات. That, oh my companions, I see you perpetrating many crimes which you trivialize. I swear by Allah, in the time of Nabi alayhi salam, these were considered as the most destructive crimes. And as we draw closer to Qiyamah, this continues. So while the world progresses definitely in technology, like one scholar mentioned, while the world boasts that now we are traveling by air, forgetting not that while we are now traveling by air, we have also polluted the air of Allah with guna. So in mid-air, wine is being consumed. In mid-air, zina is taking place. Indeed, there is growth and technology, but coupled with that is the retrogressing in morals and values. While life seems to become easier theoretically, in theory, when you analyze life today, we have such advanced modes of transport, such easy ways of communication. In theory, life seems easier than previous times, but practically life has become more challenging than the previous times. Tension, depression and frustration has, wallah, become the order of the day. Happiness, joy and prosperity is something of the past. May I repeat what I said? Tension, depression and frustration has become the order of the day. Happiness, joy and prosperity has become something of the past. Never mind becoming a victim to any tragedy, which perhaps might warrant depression. A person met in an accident, lost a beloved, lost his wealth, lost a job. Some tragedy, some calamity, some catastrophe came in his way, which definitely warrants depression. Never mind the tragedies that, you know, a person becomes a victim to any tragedy. The very fears that haunt the mind of an average man is sufficient depression. The very fears that haunt the mind of every individual that are ever lurking, I must never become poor. I must never be diagnosed of cancer. This must never happen. The fear that I ever lurking in the heart and the mind of every man is sufficient depression in the life of every person. You know, like the poet says, I wish you could understand Arabic. You can appreciate these couplets if you understand Arabic. He says, he presented in the surgery of a physician, سألت من الأطباء خبيرا ذات يوم مما شيبي. سألت من الأطباء خبيرا ذات يوم مما شيبي. فقال بلغموا. فقلت له على غير احتشام لقد اخطأت فيما قلت بلغموا. He said, I went to the doctor and I asked him, that doctor, assess me, I'm gone white. What is the reason? Mimma shaybi. Like it comes in the authentic ahadith that Nabi alayhi salam said, when Nabi alayhi salam was told, Shibta ya Rasulallah, O Nabi of Allah, you are aging, you are becoming white. Nabi alayhi salam said, Shayyabatni al-Hud wa akhawatuha. It is the frightening description of Qiyamah in Surah Hud which makes my hair white. And we learn in the authentic ahadith that there were 20 strands of white hair on the blessed body of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And another poem comes to mind while I'm saying this here. The poet says, Lana khattu walil ayyami khattu. Lana khattu walil ayyami khattu. Wa baynahuma mukhalafatul midadi. Fa aktubuhu sawadan fi bayadi. Wa taktubuhu bayadan fi sawadi. I wish you can understand Arabic. Really, you know, it has to be understood in Arabic. The time says, the poet says, I have a pen and the time has a pen. The era in which we are living, it has a pen. And as we are talking, our time is just moving away. That is why Hassan Basri said regarding the Sahaba, أَدْرَكْتُ أَقْوَامًا كَانَ أَحَدُهُمْ أَشَحَّ عَلَىٰ عُمْرِهِ مِنْهُ عَلَىٰ دِرْهَمِهِ. That I sat in the company of Sahaba and I found them more possessive over their time than their wealth. I found them, they were more possessive. They clinged onto, they were flexible with their money. They were not hard on their money, but they were very hard on their time. Nobody could take time from them. أَدْرَكْتُ أَقْوَامًا كَانَ أَحَدُهُمْ أَشَحَّ عَلَىٰ عُمْرِهِ مِنْهُ عَلَىٰ دِرْهَمِهِ. So the poet says, لَنَا خَتٌ. I have a pen and the time has a pen. وَبَيْنَهُمَا مُخَالَفَةُ الْمِدَادِ. The only difference is the ink. فَأَكْتُبُهُ سَوَادًا فِي بَيَاضِ. My pen has black ink. I write with black ink on white paper. And the time writes with white ink on black hair. فأكتبه سوادا في بياضي وتكتبه بياضا في سوادي. That is the difference. Nonetheless, he says, I asked the doctor, that doctor examine me, why am I gone white? So he said, بلغمو, you have a lot of phlegm in your body. فقلت له على غير احتشام لقد اخطأت فيما قلت بلغمو. Instantly I said, doctor, I respect your expertise. You need to understand Arabic to appreciate what has been said. I appreciate your expertise, but definitely I think this got nothing to do with phlegm, بلغمو. Instead, this is depression. This is the result of depression in my body. This is what has happened. Tap any person, let him pour his heart out to you. Every man is in crisis. إني رأيتك جالسا مستقبلي فعلمت أنك للهموم قرين. Oh my brother, I seen you sitting before me. The very gesture of your face indicated depression. هون عليك وكن بربك واثقا فأخ التوكل شأنه التهوين. Take life easy, calm down, relax. As in Australia they say, no worries. No worries, that's the term. I remember when we were there, I had to give a talk at a particular university. I met a man, he says, asked him, where are you going? I said, I've got to go to the QUT, Queensland University of Technology. So greet him, how are you? No worries. You go straight, you come to a roundabout, you take a right, you carry on straight, you come. I didn't know what the man was saying. No worries. هون عليك. Relax. Relax. وَكُمْ بِرَبِّكَ وَاثِقًا. And put your reliance on Allah. فَأَخُ التَّوَكُّلِ شَأْنُهُ التَّهْوِينُ. For verily the one that relies on Allah takes life easy. تَرَحَ الْأَذَى عَنْ نَفْسِهِ فِي رِزْقِهِ لَمَّا تَيَقَّنَ أَنَّهُ مَذْمُونُ. The only way to avert financial depression, the only way to avert and divert financial depression is to convince yourself that Allah is the sustainer. When you've convinced yourself that Allah is the sustainer, now the fluctuation in the currency, the fake predictions of the economists, the competitors in the market will not make a difference to you. So this is the modern day poverty, if we can put it that way. That in the midst of affluence, there is no joy. In the midst of comfort and luxury, there is absolutely no joy. This is the modern day poverty which stares at every person. And perhaps the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held the hand of Abu Dharr, and he said, Ya Aba Dharr, atara anna kathrat al-mal huwa al-ghina, wa qillat al-mal huwa al-faqr. Oh Abu Dharr, do you consider excess wealth, excess of provisions as wealth, and lack of provisions as poverty? I said, O Nabi of Allah, that is the apparent definition of wealth and poverty. That if you have a lot, you are successful, you are healthy, you are prosperous. And if you don't have, then you have a depressed life, you have a sick life. Nabi alayhi salam said, no, no, Abu Dharr, you have your facts muddled. Let me set the record correctly. As they say, just to put the record correctly. Nabi alayhi salam then said in the riwayat of Ibn Hibban, إِنَّمَا الْغِنَى غِنَى الْقَلْبِ وَمَنْ كَانَ الْغِنَى فِي قَلْبِهِ فَلَا يَضُرُّهُ مَا لَقِيَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. No, Abu Dharr, wealth in essence is the contentment of heart. Wealth in essence is the contentment of heart. And no Niagara Falls and no Victoria Falls can give you that contentment that is divine from Allah. وَمَنْ كَانَ الْغِنَى فِي قَلْبِهِ The one who has contentment in his heart, فَلَا يَضُرُّهُ مَا لَقِيَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Then no amount of calamities and tragedies will harm this man, will depress this man. Nothing in this world will depress this man. You see, today every man has a different perception of contentment. Every person feels, some feel that if I get married and I have a beautiful wife, that is the goal of my life. That is the aim, that is the ambition of my life. And I foresee my joy in that woman. Others feel if I pursue a degree, I graduate, I earn so much, then that is my particular accomplishment and that is the pinnacle of my joy. Like they say, four people were traveling. Or three people perhaps in a simple example. They were speaking different languages. One spoke English, one spoke Urdu, one spoke Arabic. Someone came and gave them a dollar. Now they had to split the dollar. What are they going to do with the dollar? The one that speaks Arabic, he said, Ana ashtari al-inab. Ana ashtari al-inab. I'm going to buy inab. Okay, the other one that speaks English, he said, no, I want to buy grapes. I want to buy grapes. I'm not buying inab. I'm buying grapes. The third one said, no, mujhe angur kharidna hai. I'm buying angur. He says, I don't know what's your angur. I don't know what's your inab. I want my grapes. So then came along one person who spoke all three languages. Like, they say, بِقَدْرِ لُغَاتِ الْمَرْءِ يَكْثُرُ نَفْعُهُ بِقَدْرِ لُغَاتِ الْمَرْءِ يَكْثُرُ نَفْعُهُ فَتِلْكَ لَهُ عِنْدَ الْمُلِمَّاتِ أَعْوَانُ فَبَادِرْ إِلَى حِفْظِ اللُّغَاتِ مُسَارِعًا فَكُلُّ لِسَانٍ فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ إِنْسَانُ That the more languages a person speaks, the better it is for him. So this person said, you know what, I will resolve your problems. You give me that $1 and I will get your angur, your inab and your grapes for you. I'll do everything. He went, he bought a bunch of grapes and he came and gave it. He says, this is your angur, it is your grapes and it is your inab. So the expressions are different, but the common thing is peace. Every man is searching for happiness. Every person is searching for inner contentment. And wallah, Allah has not kept in the capacity of the things of this world. You take a child, you give him an item, he fences it for a period of time, and the next day he is tired. Allah hasn't kept in the capacity of this world anything. In the capacity of this world to satisfy this restlessness of man, this crave of man, this ego of man. We continue with the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَنْ كَانَ الْفَقْرُ فِي قَلْبِهِ The one who has greed in his heart, the one who has contentment in his heart, nothing of this world, nothing. It is the perception that if you're healthy and you're wealthy, you are content. This is the deception and the delusion of the devil. Last year I had the opportunity to go to Malawi, which is the neighboring country from South Africa. The Quranic Kareem was translated in the local vernacular language for the first time, and they had the launch of the Quran, and there was the opening of the masjid, so some scholars were invited from South Africa. I was also amongst those that were invited. We were there. We went to a particular location, and this particular scene, really caught my eye, and I thought I relate it to you. There was a small little hut, which was the house of this man. Safely, I can say your laundry room is bigger than his entire house. Nearby there was a small well, there were some goats and some children were playing. It was extremely hot. There was no food, nothing, no fan, no aircon, nothing. This elderly aged man was sitting outside his particular hut in the heart of Africa, living in abject poverty. But that particular man had such a broad smile and he transmitted such warmth that I swear by Allah it left an indelible impression in my heart and my mind. And it left me thinking that really what is wealth and what is poverty? Who is wealthy and who is poor? Who is content and who is depressed?
few years ago we were in Jordan. We were hosted by a very, very wealthy man. You know, subhanallah, Allah has given him such wealth. He filters his water 16 times before it comes out of the tap. He had spent in excess of $2 million on his garden. He received us at the airport, a breathtaking view, very scenic, mashallah. He owns more than 20 food outlets in the United States. And you know, he received us, and what a beautiful atmosphere. We performed Maghrib namaz on his lawn. It's on one of the high mountains of Amman. It was really an impressive scene. But the engrossment and the engagement of that man was such, I did not cherish or admire or envy that man's wealth for a split second. And I kept on admiring the smile of this man living in abject poverty. What did the Nabi of Allah say? وَمَنْ كَانَ الْغِنَى فِي قَلْبِهِ He who has contentment in his heart, فَلَا يَضُرُّهُ مَا لَقِيَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا No calamities of this world will depress him. You see, depression, Fir'aun is sitting on his throne. The vision was sown, someone seen the vision, يُولَدُ مَوْلُودٌ يَذْهَبُ مُلْكُكَ عَلَى يَدِهِ That a child will be born and you will lose your kingdom at the hands of that child. The child is not yet born. Fir'aun is still governing. But scholars write from that day onwards, وَطَارَ نَوْمُهُ وَبَقِيَ فِرْعَوْنُ لَا يَطِيبُ لَهُ طَعَامًا وَلَا شَرَابٍ That was the end of food, drinks, happiness and joy. From that day onwards, imagine the child is not yet born. They haven't yet made the diagnosis of cancer. Doctors suspect there is cancer. That's the end of joy in the life of that man. How many people aren't they who own a lot of wealth? But because of sicknesses, they have such restrictions that the dog in that house eats better food than the owner. The man for breakfast has a very restricted diet. For lunch, he cannot have this, he cannot have that. The dog in that house eats better food. And this is what the world is chasing. This is what the world is advertising. This is what we have been brainwashed with and been exposed to. Look at that beautiful hadith in Bukhari Sharif. When there is contentment in the heart, food for thought in particular for our sisters. Ata ibn Abi Rubah says, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu tells me, Ala urika imra'atan min ahli al-jannah. Should I not show you a woman of Jannah? I said, please do tell me. He said, هَذِهِ الْمَرْأَةُ السَّوْدَىٰ أَتَتِ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ You see this woman of Abyssinian origin? Come, I tell you a story about this woman. She one day came to Nabi alayhi salam. Look at the condition in her life. It does not mean when a man has contentment, when Allah has given him, that calamities will not come. No, Allah will give him the strength to react differently. He will not get emotional by situations. Divinely Allah will inspire him, and I will elaborate on what I'm saying. Money can buy you a house, like they say, money can buy a house but not a home. Money can buy you a bed but not sleep. Person can be sleeping, you know, on water bed as they say. Insomnia is a medical condition that's only growing in the world, deprived of sleep. And on the other hand, there is a beggar, a pauper, sleeping under the tree, in mid-traffic. The people are driving, people are busy, engaged, and he's enjoying the divine sleep of Allah in the shade that Allah has provided. وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّمَّا خَلَقَ ظِلَالًا He appreciates the shade that Allah has given. And another man sitting in front of the ocean, having a beautiful view with his beloved wife on the third floor of that particular hotel, and he's tossing and turning and he cannot sleep. Where is then pleasure coming from? Look at this particular woman. She comes to Nabi alayhi salam. Ya Rasulallah, inni usra'u wa atakashab. O Nabi of Allah, I suffer from epilepsy. Now what a fatal illness she is suffering. What a sickness. Now as the world harps upon it, that you know, if you are, there's so many anti-aging products. You mustn't age, you mustn't be sick. There are so many sisters that are destroying their health just to look thin. Just to look attractive, seductive, that I must look thin, I must look appealing as this particular woman on this magazine and that magazine. Because I am made to believe that if I look thin, sweet, attractive and seductive, then I am successful and I am content. Yet that particular pill is destroying that woman, she is suffering, she is deprived of food. You know, like they say, the typical American mentality of dropping the levels of obesity is going to a particular shop, can I have a double cheesy burger and a Diet Coke? Why the levels of obesity are too high, so I'll have a Diet Coke with a double cheesy burger. So anyway, this woman comes to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulallah, inni usra. Subhanallah, look at contentment. I swear by Allah, it comes divine from Allah. O Nabi of Allah, I suffer from epilepsy. And when I have these attacks, my satr is exposed. Could you perhaps make dua to Allah that Allah cures me? Now what a tragedy in a life. It warrants total depression. Subhanallah, what are the teachings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Nabi of Allah, one was to lift his hands and instantly make dua and Allah will respond positively and cure the woman. But the Nabi of Allah gave her a choice. In shi'ti da'awtu Allah an yu'afik. Wa in shi'ti sabarti walakil jannah. You have one of two choices. If you so wish, I will make dua to Allah now. He will cure you instantly, permanently, totally. On the other hand, if you endure, persevere, and exercise patience, I promise you, Jannat is yours. Now, in today's terms, when a person understands that sickness means depression, it means medical expenses, it means burdening the family, it entails a host of other things. Naturally, a person is so desperate for cure, he'll do anything and everything. Another one, while I'm speaking about this, another hadith comes to mind. Aisha Fatima radiallahu anha comes home, she is hungry. Ali radiallahu anhu is hungry. What the world has painted as depression, and what Islam tells us with regards to contentment. There is absolutely no food. Now a person is living in difficulty, is some financial problems. Again, this warrants depression. You find today most of the circular degrees that a person pursues is in relation to his monetary return. Most of the things, a person is becoming a doctor, very few are those whose aim and whose ambition is to serve humanity. It might be a sideline, option, but the primary reason, the priority in pursuing that particular is the monetary returns. What will I get back? By giving so much, how much do I get back? These are the reasons why, because why? The perception is the day I have wealth, I am successful and I'm content. I am happy the day I have wealth. That is the end of sadness, depression. And that's apart from the depression which is as a result of guna, and I'm coming to that still. I swear by Allah, the greatest contributing factor to depression is guna. As that young boy who after he takes a pill and he's on a bus and he's on cloud nine and he's safe, floating somewhere else, as soon as he becomes sober, he goes through such depression that he's left with one of two options. Either he commits suicide or takes a pill again. There's no other choice in the life of that young boy. I personally have dealt with many youth involved in drugs. Perhaps while perpetrating the crime, he enjoys fake pleasure. But no sooner he becomes sober, he goes through such depression. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, prophesizing the things of Qiyamah, a man will come to the grave of his brother, not to respect the deceased, not to come and convey thawab to him. Yatamarrahu. He will then turn in the soil of the grave and he will say, Ya laytani kuntu makana sahiba hadha al-qabr. My brother, I envy you, you are gone. I promise you, I cannot bear the calamities of this world any longer. I wish I was beneath the soil and you were above the soil. In the midst of all the comforts that he has, أَلَا مَوْتٌ يُبَاعُ فَأَشْتَرِيهِ فَهَذَا الْعَيْشُ مَا لَا خَيْرَ فِيهِ. Someone said, I wish, can you tell me someone is selling death? I want to buy death. I'm frustrated with life. I have come here with all the comforts, all the luxuries, all the affluence. Like in Urdu they say, اب تو گبرا کے یہ کہتے ہیں کہ مر جائیں گے مر کے بھی چین نہ پایا تو کدھر جائیں گے. Now in a fit of frustration you say, I wish I die, I wish I die, I wish I die. And then they speak of euthanasia, mercy killings. اب تو گبرا کے یہ کہتے ہیں کہ مر جائیں گے. You take any youngster to a rehabilitation. When he's been admitted in that particular rehab, the first thing they ask him as the symptoms of drugs, did the thought of suicide cross your mind? That's amongst the first things. This is nothing, these antidepressant tablets. You know, they have antidepressant. I give this example, perhaps I share it with you. It's nothing. That is escapism. You're hiding the reality. You are disguising and camouflaging. You are not solving. You are not soothing. You are not unwinding. You are not relaxing. It's like a person went to a particular motor mechanic, he had a problem in his car. He says, you know what, as I'm driving, there's this very strange and peculiar sound coming out, and I can't trace the problem. So the motor mechanic had a look at the car, but he couldn't trace the problem. He says, you know what, I can't really find anything, but I got a way out. I can solve the problem for you. If it really bothers you while driving, just put your radio a bit louder. If the noise bothers you, just put your radio, and I promise you, your problem will be solved without any money. I won't take a cent from you. You just turn the volume a bit louder and that's it. I swear by Allah, that is antidepressant tablets. You have solved no problem. You have only camouflaged it. You've disguised it. The problem remains. Become sober and it's worse than what it was. That is antidepressant tablets. The riwayat of Bayhaqi, Nabi alayhi salam said, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, is the cure of 99 ailments, the least of which is depression. The least of which is depression. Inna sadaqata sir tutfi'u ghadab al-Rabbi. Let me complete that hadith. Fatima radiallahu anha comes home. There is no food. Now what happens to a man today again? The perception is that when there isn't wealth, when there isn't food, when there's sickness, these things warrant depression. In Western circles, what happened to people in this situation? So anyway, Ali radiallahu anhu tells Fatima radiallahu anhu that go to your father and ask him if there is some food. Fatima radiallahu anhu comes to the house of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How did they react to situations? Sometimes it's just the change of attitude. It's not the change of condition, it's the change of attitude that brings pleasure to life. Fatima radiallahu anha comes and knocks on the door. Umm Ayman radiallahu anha is seated by Nabi alayhi salam. From the very tone of the knock, Nabi alayhi salam said, Inna hadha lataqqu Fatima. This is my Fatima knocking at the door. وَلَقَدْ أَتَتْنَا فِي سَاعَةٍ مَا عَوَّدَتْنَا أَن تَأْتِينَا فِي مِثْلِهِ. And my Fatima has come on a strange time. Normally my Fatima will not visit me on this time. Definitely there is something that is bothering my daughter. She enters the house of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Which father wants to see his daughter coming home with hunger? And Allah forbid that don't happen. If that comes and happens to us, how would we react to the situation? We will go through depression that I don't know what and where we will go. Look at how the Nabi of Allah reacts. Nabi alayhi salam, she sits down, she then praises Nabi alayhi salam, durud and salawat on the noble personality. And then, you know, she very, in a very subtle way, she indicates, in a very modest way, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, هذه الملائكة طعامها التهليل والتسبيح والتحميد فما طعامنا. O Nabi of Allah, the angels glorify Allah perpetually, satisfy their needs by worshipping Allah. Myself, your son-in-law, and your grandchildren have absolutely no food. Could you perhaps make some arrangements? Do you know what an emotional meeting that is? Can any father contain himself? Allah, don't let ever let that happen to us. To find your daughter coming in this way, to see your grandchildren hungry. The Nabi of Allah's eyes become moist. He comes into emotions, but he calms himself down. Subhanallah, divinely contentment. Allah inspires it. The Nabi of Allah says, O Fatima, and this is what the Nabi of Allah told that woman, and I want to mention, وَمَنْ كَانَ الْغِنَى فِي قَلْبِهِ, the one who has contentment in his heart, no worldly condition will depress him. Conditions will come upon him. Conditions will come upon him. Like they say, having Allah on your side does not mean sailing on the ocean with no waves. It doesn't mean that. But having Allah on your side means sailing in such a ship which no storm can sink. That is what it means. It doesn't mean you will not have storms. You will have storms, you will have waves. But when you have Allah on your side, no storm will sink that ship. No storm will sink that ship. That is divine contentment that Allah will give. And nothing of the world can give you this. They have tried anything and everything to get that happiness. And in the end, there's nothing. When the wealth of Persia came into Medina Munawwara, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu started crying. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf said, Inna hadha layawmu sururin. Umar al-Mu'mineen, wealth, affluence, prosperity. This is a day of triumph. This is a day of victory. This is a day of joy. Such wealth we anticipate. Allah has given us. Why are you mourning when Allah is opening the days of victory? But look at the far-sightedness of Umar. How deep his sight and how far his vision was. He said, إِنَّ هَذَا الْمَالْ لَمْ يُعْتِهِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا إِلَّا أَلْقَ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمْ عَلْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءِ. Study the history of affluence. What did Sayyidina Umar say? Study the history of affluence. Whenever it came to a nation, it divided them. Whenever it came to a nation, it snatched joy from them. It took inner happiness. There were times when one person were working and 10 people were living and everybody was happy. Today 10 people are working, end of the day not one is happy. End of the month not one is happy. This is the modern day poverty. In the midst of all comforts and luxuries, there is no happiness, there is no joy. The object of nikah is that when you look at your wife, it must put an end to depression and not start depression. The object of nikah is that when you look at your wife, it must put an end to depression and not start depression. هو الذي جعل لكم, the Quran says, لتسكنوا, that when you come home and the spouses meet, that must be the end of depression, the fatigue, the frustration that the husband experienced throughout the day. The tiredness, the wife had an agenda, the children, the house, the domestic work, so many duties. Both had a long, tiring day that exhausted the respective partners. The Quran says the fundamental object of your marriage is that when you meet, it must put an end to depression. If you are meeting with your spouse and it is starting depression, I swear by Allah, even if you live in a palace and in affluence, the very fundamental object of that marriage is forfeited. وَالَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. Allah says the object of your house is it must put an end to tiredness and fatigue. Today no man can sit at home. They just want to go out. Come weekend, run. Come holiday, go. If your house can't give you comfort, then better than that is a hut. The Quran says the object of your house is it must bring inner joy, inner satisfaction, that there's no bounds, no restrictions, no formalities. You can relax yourself. You can sit as you want to. You are free and at liberty. If your house cannot contain you, cannot attract you, in English they say the one that doesn't find joy at home will find it nowhere. The one that does not find joy at home will find it nowhere. So the Nabi of Allah then tells his daughter, O Fatima, if you want, I will give you 5 sheep which someone brought and gave to me. I give it to you. You take it home, slaughter it and eat it. And if you want, علمتك خمس كلمات علمنيهن جبريل. Or otherwise I teach you 5 words, 5 ayat, 5 du'as, which if you recite will soothe you, satisfy you, your hunger, your depression, your pain, your agony, today, tomorrow, when your father is around and when he's gone. We learn from these ahadith that there is a price for this divine joy. There was nothing wrong for the Nabi of Allah to say, yeah, my daughter, take the sheep also and take the du'as also. But he didn't do that. He said, take the sheep or the dua, one of the two. Bearing in mind, this is a father who sees his own daughter hungry. There's no words of any language that can translate the emotions of such a father. And Fatima, whom my Nabi loved the most, من أحبها فقد أحبني ومن آذاها فقد آذاني. Whoever loves my Fatima loves me. Whoever dislikes my Fatima dislikes me. Hassan and Hussein, the coolness of my eyes. She said, O Nabi of Allah, I will prefer those 5 words. I will prefer it. Nabi alayhi salam says, okay, then say after me, O my daughter, Ya awwal al-awwaleen, wa ya akhir al-akhirin, wa ya rahim al-masakeen, ya dhal quwwati al-mateen, ya arham al-rahimeen. She takes this, she reads this, she goes home, she returns to her husband. Imagine your wife send you with a shopping list and you come back with a dua. Never mind, you know, you just come back with a different item and you know what happens. You know, like they say, this particular woman, she came home, her husband, he brought tomatoes for his wife. came and he left it there in a packet. She says, no, I don't want this one. I want the one in the box, man, the one in the wooden box. He said, oh, okay, no problem. He went outside. He found a wooden box, took it, put the tomatoes inside, got some names, brought it over. He says, yeah, this is the one I wanted. Anyway, she comes with dua. Now what I'm saying, these are situations that bring depression to us. I don't know, has the tragedies of our times become more, or has our forbearance levels dropped more? Petty things today, trivial things, a man goes through depression. And immediately, you know, he needs to do this, he needs to go, you know, he's back onto his drugs, he's doing this, he's doing trivial things, and a person cannot contain himself. Petty issues, and a man is divorcing his wife. And subhanAllah, look at this condition. Husband, wife and children, all are hungry. She comes home, she reads the du'as to her husband. The husband is happy. The children, they soothe the children. The children are too young, too tender to fathom, to appreciate. But how Allah gave contentment to Fatima through this du'a, Fatima's hunger was the price of this contentment. I said it on a full stomach, my brother, you heard it on a full stomach. Neither I can appreciate what this dua can do, neither you can appreciate. I and you both will have to collectively knock the door of Fatima to understand the hidden tranquility that Allah has kept in this dua. Neither I nor you, the tranquility that Allah has kept and how soothing this dua is, that we'll have to ask Fatima, her hunger and the hunger of her husband and her children collectively was the result of the divine tranquility that Allah provided to her. Like they say, this person was sitting and relaxing. So someone said, get up and do something good in your life, man. What are you wasting your life for? He said, what must I do? He says, go work and make some money, man. And then get married. And then, well, you can perhaps go for a vacation. And then what? Sit by the beach and relax. He said, well, I'm doing that now. I'm doing that now. Why must I go through all those procedures? Must I go through 5 procedures? I'm relaxing now. إن أنا لم أفز بمراد سعي وكم من حسرة تحت التراب. If I did not accomplish my material goal in life, what's the harm? You died as a doctor, I died as an ignorant man, but then we entered through one door. Why? What's the fuss? You made it, well and good. I didn't make it, well, what's the difference? End of the day, who is happy in his life? Who has divine happiness and joy? Do some soul searching. And ask yourself, the Nabi of Allah asked this woman, if you want to make dua to Allah, Allah will cure you. And if you want, you make sabr in Jannah. Now she is suffering epilepsy. Subhanallah, contentment. She says, oh Nabi of Allah, if you promise that I have patience, Jannah is mine, then I will prefer living with this sickness. And I will prefer dying with the sickness. As long as you can confirm Jannah is mine. However, I am very conscious of my modesty. And when I have my epilepsy attacks, my sitr is unveiled and it is exposed. I want you to make that amount of dua that in the future attacks that I have, my sitr mustn't be unveiled. There was a time when a woman was conscious of her morality in the midst of sickness, which perhaps anyone can debate as she been excused in the sense of the sickness that she has. The Nabi of Allah made dua that in the future attacks that she has, her sitr mustn't be exposed. But Allah gave her contentment on her sickness. Allah gave her contentment on her sickness. She lived with epilepsy, she died with epilepsy. And on the tongue of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, her abode in Jannah was confirmed. Hence it is a perception, it is a deception, it is a delusion that if I am healthy and I am wealthy, I am successful and I am content. هي القناعة فلزمها تعش ملكا لو لم يكن منها إلا راحة البدن. It is contentment. Grab onto it. I swear by Allah, if you have it, you're a king without a throne also. وانظر لمن ملك الدنيا بأجمعها. And look at those who own the entire world. Those who own the entire world. هل راح منها بغير القطن والكفن. Those that went, they all went in the same way, nothing more. Like in Arabic they say, لا تتفكر في ثلاثة أشياء. Don't think about 3 things, this will add to your depression. فيكثر همك وغمك ويزيد في حرصك. This is the formula of depression. This is the formula of getting depressed. And today, inevitably, every man has this in his mind. لا تتفكر في فقرك. Don't think about the day I won't have money. Today I lose my job. Today this happens to me. Don't plan. Don't fear. Don't sit and think about the moments where I won't have wealth. Why? This will only increase your greed, and it will add to your anxiety, and it will multiply your depression. Number two. لا تتفكر في طول البقاء. Do not plan a long future in life. Allah alone knows the destiny of every man. But if a person plans a long future, then he will have to amass much more, because he'll say, at the age of 70, I need this. At 80, I'll need this. At 90, I'll need this, because I'm around till 100. Like, تؤمل في الدنيا. You know, these couplets are so beautiful. تؤمل في الدنيا طويل ولا تدري إذا جن ليل هل تعيش إلى الفجر. فكم من صحيح مات من غير علة، وكم من عليل عاش دهرا إلى دهري، وكم من فتى يمسي ويصبح آمنا وقد نسجت أكفانه وهو لا يدري. تؤمل في الدنيا الطويل. Oh my brother, you are very ambitious in this world. Yet when the night sets in, you don't know if you will see dawn or not. ولا تدري إذا جن ليل هل تعيش إلى الفجر. فكم من صحيح مات من غير علة. There are so many healthy people who died without any apparent reason. وكم من عليل عاش دهرا إلى دهري. And there are so many people who are fatally ill yet lived for decades. وكم من فتى يمسي ويصبح آمنا وقد نسجت أكفانه وهو لا يدري. And there are so many youth. So the concluding couplets. There are so many youth who live in comfort and affluence, knowing not that the coffin in which he will be wrapped has been prepared, and the hole in which he will be lowered has been dug. وَكَمْ مِنْ فَتَنْ. He gets up proud and arrogant, knowing not that my grave has been dug at this moment. So do not plan a long future. Allah alone knows this will add to your depression. As I was mentioning, brothers, the greatest contributing factor to depression, Allah's qasam, is guna. There is nothing that will depress a man more than sin. Nabi alayhi salam says in the hadith, inna as-sidqa tamanina. Today we find a person, we are living in such a promiscuous society. Such promiscuity, it is inconceivable. I was listening to a radio program back home in South Africa, and they were talking about, you know, having an affair with strange woman. And this particular, I don't know if you can call him a human, but anyway, he phones in and he speaks about his experiences, and he says, well, I had relation with 1,000 women. People actually started calculating his age, and you know, they even made a joke and they said, I think you possess a weapon of mass destruction. That is a weapon of mass destruction. 1,000 women? Such a promiscuous society we are living in. And there is no joy. Allah's qasam, the greatest thing is sin. Nabi alayhi salam said, inna as-sidqa tamanina. Listen to the words of Nabi alayhi salam. Honesty provides tranquility. Honesty in your dealings, in your interaction, provides divine happiness, joy, satisfaction. Now extend the realms of that hadith. Broaden the scope of that hadith. Let's extend the explanation. Explore that hadith. Honesty, piety, integrity, loyalty, fidelity provides divine happiness, joy, and satisfaction. And Nabi alayhi salam says, lies, sin, vice provides restlessness, uneasiness, depression, frustration. Ask a man pursuing an unlawful relation. My wife doesn't get hold of my phone. Whoever is at the door, run quickly. I better see who's coming. He's constantly, he's on his nerves all the time. Nobody must come to know my wrong. The depression that results out of that sin. The nature of the devil is, and this in particular I want to address to my youth. The Quran speaks about this here. That when the devil provokes a person towards a sin, and he paints the picture that you make zina and you will be happy. You take this pill and that will be the end of pain in your life. And you know, that is it. كَمَثَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِذْ قَالَ لِلْإِنسَانِ اكْفُرْ كمثل الشيطان إذ قال للإنسان اكفر فلما كفر قال إني بريء منك إني أخاف الله رب العالمين. فكان عاقبتهما أنهما في النار خالدين فيها وذلك جزاء الظالمين. The similitude of the devil when he incites and provokes you to a sin. Now when a devil provokes you to a sin, then he plans the sin for you. He also answers all the perhaps the possible leak outs of the sin. That if you come late, what you'll tell your wife? No, you can tell her you got delayed at work. On the way, if this happened, all the apparent faults and loopholes that perhaps could be a setback, the devil answers everything. Instantly, the mind is running. The mind is running. The devil is flowing. The sin is vivid before him. He's got a choice. Either he does it or not. It looks very tempting, very appealing, very convincing, very, you know, if I do it, this is what I actually need in my life. It will be the end of this depression and tiredness and fatigue and whatever else as it is. A beautiful massage, you know, by gentle hands. What more do I need? So the devil provokes him up. And the devil says, do it, and I'm with you all the way. And look here, after all, when the brothers of Yusuf intended killing Yusuf, then immediately at that time, and I'm going to tell you something very important, listen to what I got to say, brothers. At that particular moment, the devil told them, وَتَكُونُوا مِن بَعْدِهِ قَوْمًا صَالِحِينَ. That you commit this act, you kill your brother out of jealousy. Out of jealousy, kill your brother, get rid of him. يَخْلُ لَكُمْ وَجْهُ أَبِيكُمْ. The focus of your father will then be exclusive on you. And after the sin, after all, Allah is forgiving. If you won't commit sins, who will Allah forgive? Scholars explain, to think of the mercy of Allah prior to committing a sin. To think of the mercy of Allah prior to committing a sin is like saying, burn yourself. I've got an ointment for burnt fingers, so burn yourself. I bought this ointment. If I'm not going to burn myself, who's going to use this ointment? So let me burn myself. Let me burn myself. I mean, I bought it here in case something happens, so let me burn. That is not the time to reflect on the mercy of Allah. Scholars explain, if a person ponders over the mercy and the forgiveness, the kindness and the tolerance, the respite and the clemency of Allah prior to perpetrating a sin, his minor sin will become a major sin. That is what will happen. Oh, my Allah is so forgiving. I don't need to just look at this woman. I can have zina with her. When my Allah can forgive so much, let me satisfy myself totally. That is not the time to look at how merciful Allah is. After you have perpetrated, and for some reason or the other, we are humans, we succumb to the evil forces within us. At times it happens. We do succumb. We give in. We don't know why we're committing it, why we're perpetrating it. But for some reason, we succumb to that evil force. After this, and yes, reflect over the mercy of Allah. Do not despair. But never to think of the mercy of Allah prior to committing a sin. That's not the time. So the devil plans everything, and he reminds you of how forgiving Allah is also. And he promises you do this. فَلَمَّا كَفَرْ When you make kufr, when you make zina, when you take that pill, and after you become sober, such depression engulfs your heart. What does the Quran say? وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْإِنسَانِ خَذُولًا وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْإِنسَانِ خَذُولًا. The support, the encouragement, the person standing with you and provoking you with the devil, as soon as you perpetrate, he withdraws. The Quran says, Khannas, min sharril waswasil khannas. Khannas, oh Allah, I seek your evil from the sneaking whisperer who comes, sneaks, withdraws. So after you've perpetrated the crime, he withdraws totally. I'm not with you. Now you do what you, inni akhaf Allah, I got nothing to do with you. Now you, tough luck to you, my friend. You did it, you suffer it. The only way I can join you again is if you go back to that woman. If you take the pill again, I stand with you. Hence, you will see a person committed a crime to satisfy himself. One after the other, he went deeper and deeper, deeper. You know, like they have that bungee jumping, you flow one way. He goes deeper and deeper into that sin, and there's no way he's coming back. Life looks so dark for him, there's no way out. In the Battle of Badr, Shaitan came to Abu Sufyan in the form of Suraqa as the leader of the tribe of Kinana, and he told him, وَإِذْ زَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ وَأَعْمَالَهُمْ وَقَالَ لَا غَالِبَ لَكُمُ الْيَوْمَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَإِنِّي جَارٌ لَكُمْ. I am with you. Don't worry, I will support you, I will encourage you, I will help you, you will defeat the Muslims. فَلَمَّا تَرَاءَتِ الْفِئَتَانِ. But when reality stared and the two armies met with one another, نَكَسَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ, as is the nature of the devil, he withdraws and he fled the battle. So Abu Sufyan asked him, oh Suraqa, where are you? You promised me, you encouraged me, you motivated me. قَالَ إِنِّي, what did he say? نَكَسَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ وَقَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْكُمْ إِنِّي أَرَىٰ مَا لَا تَرَوْنَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. No, no, I can see divine angels coming. I've got nothing. You involve, you suffer the consequences. So there is the result of depression that will come as gunah. It will never come to an end. And scholars write, worse than that sin is four things. أَرْبَعٌ بَعْدَ الذَّنْبِ شَرٌ مِّنَ الذَّنْبِ الْإِسْتِصْغَارِ وَالْإِسْتِبْشَارِ وَالْإِغْرَارِ. After committing that sin, to consider it as trivial is worse than the sin. After committing the sin, to rejoice over the sin, that you rejoice over the calamity you have done, over the sin you've perpetrated. Nabi alayhi salam says in the hadith, كُلُّ أُمَّتِي مُعَافًا إِلَّا الْمُجَاهِرِينَ. Allah is prepared to forgive every person with the exception of those that sin openly. With the exception of those that sin openly. And amongst those that are guilty of sinning openly are people who sin by night secretly. They sin by night, وَقَدْ بَاتَ يَسْتُرُهُ رَبُّهُ. And Allah conceals the man's sin. He does a sin, commits zina, takes a pill, does whatever wrong. And then in the morning he gets up and he doesn't rest until he doesn't unveil the veil of Allah. And he goes and says, I enjoyed this woman and I had this wine to bring this pleasure. Such a man has committed a crime which is unpardonable in the eyes of Allah. So contentment comes from Allah. It comes on the obedience of Allah. Let me explain to you the incident. I don't know what is my time allocation. I think I just got to worry about my flight and that's about it. But anyway, let me explain to you an incident. When Allah wants to give peace in the battle of Uhud, you see, it's got nothing to do with wealth. It's got nothing to do with health. In fact, the ayah that I recited that I really want to explore, we haven't started. And that is what Allah says, whoever will obey Allah, Allah promises a good life. What is the definition of a good life? It's the perception that it's a healthy and a wealthy life. Let's define. Let's have a common definition of a good life. And on the other hand, Allah says, whoever disobeys Allah, Allah will give him a narrowed life. The apparent life that the kuffar have is wealth, affluence, comfort, fame, luxury. And yet the Quran says every kafir has a narrowed life. And the believers, Allah says, those who obey Allah, they will have a good life. The most deserving for this good life is the galaxy of the prophets and the noble companions of Nabi alayhi salam, because the quality of iman and amal salihah was found in them to the highest extent. Nobody could have this more than them. And hence we do not find health and wealth common amongst all the prophets. At times perhaps it could define a good life, but it doesn't necessarily entail the total definition of a good life. Perhaps Allah gives it to some. Allah gave it to Sulaiman alayhi salam. What a kingdom, what a dominion, what a vast empire Allah had given him. Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salatu was salam. Scholars write two things define a good life and a content. This is the definition of a good life which Allah promises. The first is that whatever situation comes in your life, Allah gives you the ability to focus on the reward promised in that challenge in Akhirah. What does Allah give you? That this condition has come upon you, like I spoke about Fatima, I spoke about radiallahu anha and that woman. A challenge comes on you. The definition of a good life is Allah enables you, Allah empowers you, Allah enriches you. This is not something that I can say or you can purchase. This is divinely inspired. Allah enables you to focus. This is the challenge, this is the calamity, this is on me in my life. This is what my Allah has kept for me in Akhirah. And the second thing that defines a good life is that Allah gives you contentment. Now let's just briefly run through the life of Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah had given him health, wealth, comfort, luxury, affluence. You name it and he had it. 80 years of total prosperity. Thereafter Allah decided to test him. Allah tested him in such a way, Allah took everything. Allah took all his farms, all his orchards, everything burnt away. The roof of his house, and this is authentic narrations, the roof of his house collapsed, causing all the occupants of his house that were his 14 children to die instantly. A person loses one child and never recovers. The trauma of it never recovers. He or she is never the same human onwards. 14 children he loses at one instance. He loses all his farms, and that's not all. He develops such a sickness that he has ulcers on his entire body. The only pillar of support that he had was his wife. And as I mentioned, the fundamental object of marriage is to put an end to depression and not to start depression. The Quran says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمًا. The primary reason behind marriage is that it puts an end to depression, it puts happiness, joy, solace and bliss. And by virtue of the bond of marriage, Allah promises two, love and mercy, love and mercy. بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمًا. Scholars write, generally love translates itself in the initial stages of the marriage. قِيلَ الْمَوَدَّةَ لِلشَّابَّ وَالرَّحْمَةَ لِلْعَجُوزِ. And mercy for the respective partners often translates in the latter part of the marriage. In the initial stages, it's more motivated by love and lust. So anyway, the pillar of support for him was his wife. His wife was the granddaughter of Yusuf alayhi salam. وَقَدْ رَافَقَتْ هَذِهِ الْمَرْأَةُ حَيَاةَ نِعْمَتِهِ وَصِحَّتِهِ وَزَمَنَ بُؤْسِهِ وَبَلَائِهِ فَكَانَتْ فِي الْحَالَيْنِ مَعَ زَوْجِهَا شَاكِرَةً صَابِرَةً. This woman seen the era of prosperity. When things are good, then the partner says, "Oh, wonderful husband, wonderful. What more to complain? Why? Because life is prosperous, everything is going well. But when difficulties comes, when challenges sets in, now this is the time to support your partner. More than often in Western circles, these marriages dissolve. Why? Because there are challenges. But look at through this bond. When Allah gives contentment in the midst of difficulties, what joy there is. Like, I'm a subhanallah, you know, they say in Arabic, أَهْلُ اللَّيْلِ فِي لَيْلِهِمْ أَلَذُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ اللَّهْوِ فِي لَهْوِهِمْ. أَهْلُ اللَّيْلِ فِي لَيْلِهِمْ أَلَذُّ. Allah's qasam, the joy that people derive in disturbing their sleep, in disturbing their sleep and making wuzu in cold water and enjoying the privilege of communicating with Allah in the dead of night is much greater and much more than that young boy who's sitting on the lap of a beautiful, seductive, strange woman in the heart of a club with a bottle of wine in his hand. My brother, you have tasted the fake pleasure. You've seen how it has deceived you. I call you in this gathering and I invite you and I implore you. I introduce you to divine pleasure. I introduce you to spiritual pleasure. Wallah, there is such pleasure in salah. A time may Allah favor you with it, one and all. That moment comes in your life, Allah's qasam. I don't want to sit in, you know, it's not something I want to mention. Where you will go in sajda. And I promise you, you will derive such pleasure. Allah's qasam in whose control is my life, you won't able to lift your head up. May Allah give it to you, say Ameen. I promise you, brothers, I can tear and say it. There are those moments which Allah gives. رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا. You know, one is you crave for a woman, you crave for a pill, you crave for a sin. And one is you crave for Allah. It's not even the correct term and phrase to use. You know, it has filthy connotations, crave. But you love Allah and you sit in sajda and you feel the presence of your Allah and you feel that closeness to Allah that you, wallah, I swear by Allah, you can't lift your head up. You just cannot. It's like you're stuck. There's something between you and your Creator. You'll forget that fake pleasure. أَهْلُ اللَّيْلِ فِي لَيْلِهِمْ ألذ من أهل اللهو في لهوهم. It comes in the Hasha of Tafsir Uthmani, this quotation, that the joy of those that obey Allah and their pleasure. Imam Yusuf rahmatullah alayhi used to say, if the kings knew the pleasure we got in reading kitab, they would throw their kingdom and they would study kitabs. They would abandon. You know, I often have this, and I share this as a sense of joy. When you're studying the kitab at times till late, and you come across some new point, some new hadith, something that you could perhaps convey, it's such joy. I don't know how to express it. Where you've discovered a new point, a new tafsir, a new commentary. You've arrived at a new conclusion. And it's midnight and everyone is sleeping. And subhanallah, you come to a conclusion and you deduce some point. It is a pleasure which I cannot translate in words. So what happens to Ayyub alayhi salam? The pillar of support was his wife. And she stands by his side. She stood in the days of prosperity as well as the days of difficulty. But as life continued, 7 years of difficulty, Ayyub alayhi salam, the sickness took a toll on her. We often sympathize on a person that is sick. We forget to sympathize with those living with a sick person. At times they need more sympathy than the sick person. What about those that are living with a sick person? So it started taking a toll on her. 7 years lapsed. She comes to her husband. She says, don't you think it's high time you make dua to Allah that now He cures you and, you know, once again restores your health and we can see prosperity again. The tunnel is dark. It's raining. It's pouring. Life is narrowing upon us. Don't you think perhaps if Allah can open up things in our life and we have a more brighter future? But this is a Nabi of Allah. He asks his wife, kam labithtu fir raha? Oh my wife, how long did we enjoy health and prosperity? So she said, 80 years, 8 decades. Kam labithtu fil bala? How long did we live in difficulty and how long am I sick and how long is it since we lost our children? So she said, it's 7 years, if I recall correct, since this difficulties came in our life. So Sayyidina Ayyub said, Ama astahi an atlub min Allahi raf'a bala'i wa ma qadaytu fihi muddata rakha'i. That I enjoyed prosperity for 80 years and Allah has only tested me for 7 years. I feel shy. I feel embarrassed to ask Allah to substitute this difficulty by prosperity when I enjoyed the divine privileges of my Lord for 80 years and my Allah has only tested me for 7 years. I am not going to ask Him to cure me. Patiently I will bear. The time He divinely decides my cure, well and good.
May Allah Ta'ala favor myself and one and all with divine contentment that we have enough time for both deen and dunya. May Allah Ta'ala inspire us with the true tranquility which He has promised in Quran and Hadith. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.